there's a petrified forest in Antarctica, peeking through perpetual snow, where today nothing bigger than bacteria grows. The trees look about like Christmas trees, but instead of needles, these had leaves. They grew thick and tall at 1,000 or more per acre, and reached up to 80 feet. They date back to the late Permian, 260 million years ago, one of the many times when Earth appears to have been much warmer than today. From a catastrophist's point of view, there's a lot of questions raised by this particular Antarctic forest. How accurate is the system we use to date these trees? Was late Permian really 260 million years ago? Geologists consider this figure accurate, along with the known age of the Earth, and it's all backed by absolute radiometric dating techniques. Of course, 50 years ago, they were equally confident of a different age, and another age 50 years before that. But this time, well, they're sure they've got it right. There are two basic assumptions on which we base radiometric dating here on Earth. One is that our beautiful blue planet is an isolated body in space, unaffected by interactions with other bodies, and that the decay constant is a constant, constantly. No matter what, no matter where, the half-life of a particular radioactive isotope remains the same. Catastrophists, sounds like a dangerous job, who collect evidence that the Earth has been subjected to discontinuous and disruptive events are quick to point out the flaws in radiometric dating results. Why, you ask? Well, a quick search of Ian Trestman's Catastrophism CD online will generate 101 different references to radiometric dating in catastrophic literature. Now, most of these articles are about anomalies that don't match the settled science, and how they're explained away by those who accept the conventional dating system without question. Others refer to research showing that changing electric fields can change the decay rate. In addition, Russian researchers, Simon Schnall and others, have been studying the effects of celestial cycles on the decay constant for over 30 years. They document changes to the decay constant and the chemical reaction rates that correlate with moonrise and moonset, eclipses, the sidereal and sidenautic day, the year, and sunspots. Now, each of these cycles shows that the decay rate is connected to something. From an electric universe model point of view, that something is probably electric currents in space. The sinodic day variations, that is, sunrise to sunset, would correlate to the sun's electric currents, while the sidereal variations, from star rise to star rise, just under 4 minutes shorter than the sinodic day, would correlate to something from beyond the solar system, such as galactic electric currents. But Mr. Narrator, surely there's no way our vaunted experts could be mistaken about the radioactive decay rate. Why, just look at what a great job they did on the speed of light constant. Oh, right. Well, it turns out Rupert Sheldrake did take a peek at that. In fact, he waltzed on down to the Patent Office Library in London, which is the only place you can find the old speed of light, and discovered that the holiest of holy of constants dropped between 1928 and 1945 by about 20 kilometers per second. Now, that might not seem like much, but when you're calculating errors within nanoseconds, it's significant. Yet all over the world, the speed drop was measured and recorded, only to go back up again in 1945. Kind of makes me wonder what it says these days. So, we've got two possibilities here, ladies and gentlemen. Either we have a bunch of unscrupulous ne'er-do-wells copying each other's homework to come up with the same answer, or the speed of light isn't so constant after all. Something that would make perfect sense in an electric universe, but acts much like an entire fruit basket rammed up the tailpipe of the Standard Model's rolling tenement. To give this topic proper treatment, it really needs its own show, so we'll get into this more later. But it seems pretty likely that the constants we've been assured never change are changing. If catastrophic changes to the solar system have occurred, then radio decay constants have changed. And if the plasma discharge phenomena we call the Thunderbolts of the Gods actually flew between Earth and the other planets, this too would have changed the radio decay constant, as well as the abundances of radioisotopes. In any case, the whole question of absolute dating must be reevaluated from an electric universe point of view. I mean, unless we want to keep getting it wrong. In fact, the electric force can do all sorts of interesting things. You think changing the radioactive decay rate is impressive? Well, according to the brilliant and multi-talented archaeologist Peter Mungo Jupp, the terrifying lightning of our murky and obscenely misunderstood ancient past is responsible for flash freezing entire fields of flora and fauna. Everything from massive prehistoric trees to rudely interrupted mammoths who got stoned halfway through breakfast. But not in a good way. Here's a crab jolted into petrified rock and enclosed in the center of a basalt thunder egg, like Superman's enemies are enclosed in glass and sent spiraling into the galaxy, like the Big Bang Theory should be. And this poor dinosaur had enough juice running through him to turn all four chambers of his perfectly preserved heart into solid iron. Here's an entire shoal of fish flash frozen in limestone. No, they weren't dancing in school, ladies and gentlemen. Those are horrific death throes. Now you'd think something that could do all that, as well as be an invisible magic force that makes everything go, would be worth including into the mainstream Puzzle Factory's version of space, but you'd be sadly mistaken, dear listener. Countless examples of cataclysmic electricity directly impacting our world can be found through Jupp, David Talbot's, and especially Andy Hall's work. But of course, all hyperbolic nonsense with zero foundation in truth. Our experts know that there have never been any sorts of cataclysmic electrical activity that could have largely impacted Earth for a fact. And you're a crackpot if you disagree. Which is why the Lakota Nation says the following. Quote, "The Creator sang the song of destruction and set down fierce thunderbirds to wage a great battle against the other humans and giant animals. They fought for a very long time because the evil humans and animals had become very powerful. Finally, at the height of the battle, the thunderbirds suddenly threw down their most powerful thunderbolts, all at once. The fiery blast shook the entire world, toppling mountain ranges and setting forests and prairies ablaze. The flames leapt up to the sky in all directions, sparing only a few people at the highest peaks. It was so hot that the world's lakes boiled up and dried before their eyes. Even the rocks burned red hot, and the giant animals and evil people burned up where they stood. A great flood followed, and when the survivors went out, they found the bleached bones of the giant animals in mud and rock all over the world." End quote. So here again we find the electric force interacting with and on natural processes we thought we understood, when clearly we don't. The experts at Big Space largely ignore it, and the massive powers of change, creation, and destruction that come with it. From instant fossilization of long-dead megaflora and megafauna, as seen in Peter Mungo Jupp's work, to the vast pillars of upside-down cosmic lightning that fuel our superstorms, or the mile-high whirlwinds of Mars and gargantuan Birkeland currents that cross our visible universe from supercluster to supercluster. It's clear the electric force is the cornerstone of our reality. So help us spread the word and tell a friend about this amazing electric universe. Thank you.